Let's Talk Books, the official podcast of Book Expo America, BEA. On this episode, we talk with Ted Adams, CEO and publisher of IDW Publishing.
So Ted, tell us a little bit about the company and what you've been doing these many years.
Yeah, so I'm actually CEO of two companies. One is called IDW Media Holdings, and that's a public company that trades under the ticker symbol IDWM. And then underneath IDW Media Holdings, there are two companies, the IDW Businesses and then a company called CTM. And I'm also the CEO and publisher at IDW. And that's the business that I founded. It'll be 17 years on April 10th. So at the operational level, I'm in charge of the IDW Businesses. And that includes our publishing business, which is primarily comics and graphic novels, although we also do some prose books. And then we have a games division, which is not video games, but actually board games and card games. And then we have an entertainment division where we're financing the production of TV shows.
And when you first started, were you more in the creative side of things?
Yeah, I've always been kind of a creative executive. So in the early days of IDW, I did a lot of the writing for the company. I've always overseen the publishing schedule. I'm not in the weeds as much as I used to be, as much as I probably like to be, but I certainly, on big projects, I'm involved at the high level of editorial, helping to make decisions, publishing frequency, all those kinds of things. But yeah, I'm very much, my passion is in books. And so as much as the company has grown, I still do have my fingers in the publishing side of the business.
And how did you make the steps toward being more of an innovative publisher?
Even though I'm CEO of a public company and operational CEO of a couple of divisions, I'm still consider myself an entrepreneur. And so I try to be entrepreneurial within these fairly mature businesses. I mean, 17 years is a pretty long running business at that point. And so the way that I can be entrepreneurial is to break distribution, meaning getting our products into new places. We were one of the early pioneers of ebooks for comic books. We were having our comics sold on phones long before the iPhone. So back in the days of the flip phones, we were the first major comic publisher to have our content available as ebooks, and we've been very aggressive in that space. We were first or one of the first with Humble Bundle and just been very aggressive with digital distribution. On the physical distribution side, we've also been very aggressive. My goal as a publisher and as CEO of a public company is to try and get our content in the hands of as many people as possible. So we have been for a long time sold to Scholastic book fairs and book clubs, which is a good distribution point for our kids' books. We pioneered a format called the Microcomic Fun Pack, which is a comic book that's a little bit bigger than a trading card and comes with some other things like sticker sheets and posters and tattoos. And the reason that we did that was it allowed us to get distribution in the trading card section at mass. So when you go to places like Walmart, Toys R Us, Target, our content is sold there. So again, we're really expanding distribution for comic books in a way that no other publisher was. On the other side of the spectrum, we also have so those are probably the smallest comic books on the planet. We also have the largest comic books. We have a line of books called Artist Editions. And what we do there is we actually reproduce the art at the size that the artist drew it, and then it's scanned in a way so that it actually looks like original art. And so we pioneered that format as well, I guess going on 3 years ago now, and it's been very successful for us.
Were those difficult ideas to actually implement and become reality?
They both bring different challenges. The Fun Pack is a very high volume product that has complexity in the way it's manufactured because it has all these different components that then have to come under one wrapper. So it's extremely complicated product to manufacture. On the other end of the spectrum, the Artist Edition, which again are enormous books, sometimes 3 feet tall, those, while they don't have the big runs of a Fun Pack, on those books, they have to be perfect. You know, they're very expensive books, and we want them to be perfect. So we have very high quality demands. We're fortunate that we've been working with the same printer for more than a decade, and he's also very entrepreneurial and is always willing to roll up his sleeves and help us figure out how to get these things done. So he actually helps us manufacture the Fun Packs and the Artist Editions and everything in between. So he really is an integral part of our team.
When you look at the traditional publishing industry, do you see ideas like what you just explained being able to work with a more traditional set of content?
I think it's more the specialty publishers like us. I think Tashin, clearly Tashin is a role model for us on our high-end books. On the other side of the spectrum, I don't know that there's really anybody doing things like Fun Packs, at least not that I've seen. You know, so I think that we're, because of our size, we can be a lot more nimble than the giant publishing behemoths that are out there. And again, we're very entrepreneurial. It starts with me, and I like to think it trickles down all the way through the entire company.
Do you feel that one needs to be entrepreneurial in order to survive now?
Yeah, I think about how I've interfaced with entertainment over my lifetime. You know, when I was a kid, I'm 47. So when I was a kid, I was growing up in the 70s and in high school in the 80s. And, you know, there was a limited amount of entertainment. And so there weren't all that many TV channels. You weren't able to access every single book that had been published, either in physical or digital, all at once. And so, you know, so our choices were very limited compared to what we have today. And so I think that people who are in the business of creating entertainment have to figure out a way to get that content in front of people. And also you have to be much more niche oriented than you used to be. And one of the things that I think a lot about is, one of my favorite authors is Stephen King, who of course has an enormous audience and a well-deserved enormous audience. I've literally read everything he's written. But I think a guy like Stephen King, it's hard to break an author like that in 2016 in the way that you could back in the 70s. Again, because there were fewer books, there were fewer entertainment options. And so somebody like Stephen King could really start to build an audience and then build it for generations into this enormous audience he has today. So I think just by nature, outside of people like Stephen King or J.K. Rowling or John Grisham or these guys that have these huge built-in audiences that they've garnered over generations, we need to be a little more niche in thinking about how we can reach people and being nimble and smart.
What kind of things do you do to keep on top of this, these changes, these technologies?
For me, it's listening to the people around me, trying to be smart and thinking to myself about how I interface with entertainment. These days, I get a lot of my entertainment, at least on the TV side, from iTunes. So when we started getting the TV business with IDW Entertainment, that was, of course, a big strategy for us, trying to make sure that we had season passes available and making sure that they're competitively priced. And within that season pass right now, we have a show, Wynonna Earp, that premieres on Sci-Fi on April 1st at 10 o'clock. The show is also available to purchase on iTunes as a season pass. And then when you go to iTunes, it'll also give you the option to buy our comic book. So it's really trying to help people connect those dots. If you like the TV show, hopefully you'll buy the comic. If you like the comic, hopefully you'll check out the TV show.
Ted, you're trapped on a deserted island. You can only take one book with you. What book will it be and why?
Wow, that is a good question. If I could only take one book with me, even though it's a short book, it's probably the one I would take, and that's Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas by Hunter Thompson. Although my lifestyle is about as different from Hunter's as you probably could get, his writing really influenced me in a big way, and it kind of changed the way I looked at the world, and it led me to read his books about the campaign trail and the other writings that he produced over his lifetime. And so while we don't necessarily have the same vices, he's somebody I admire and somebody I think that helped me figure out how to question the world in a way that made me smarter.
Please complete this sentence. I read because
I have always read. I guess, you know, it's hard for me to say it in a sentence, but I read for lots of reasons. I read for entertainment, of course. You know, there's nothing better than a good book. My preferred form of entertainment is reading. But I also read to educate myself. I'm a voracious reader of everything. And so I'm reading magazines. I still read a daily newspaper. I read nonfiction. I read fiction. I think it helps me be a more well-rounded person and hopefully a more intelligent person. And the biggest problem with my job, which has become a fairly big job, is I don't have as much time to read as I used to. So now I'm listening to audiobooks on my commute, and I'm reading at lunch when I don't have a lunch appointment. And so it truly is my passion.
Let's Talk Books is a production of Book Expo America, BEA, the leading book and author event for the North American publishing industry. Join us in Chicago for BEA 2016, May 11th through 13th at McCormick Place. For more information on this episode and BEA, visit bookexpoamerica.com.